Have been, of course, communists and who have passed through anti-fascistic struggle. So this student critic for them was very uncomfortable. Very uncomfortable because they had a bad conscience. They said those youngsters are now saying we did not realize, we did not make true all the promises. So, of course, the students could not move out of the faculties. The press did not write anything real about all those demands. And today, 50 years after, this small document, it is among the rare documents which shows what was really happening. And why it is important? That is this importance of documentary film. Today, even old politicians of my age and even older in today's post-socialism, what they do? They lie completely. They say, I was protesting in 68, I wanted more religion, we wanted a capitalism, we wanted multicultural system. So the man who is quoting Karl Marx, he's a president of Serbian parliament. He's Professor Dragoljub Mićunović. And he said to me, Želimir, don't show this film, you know. So you see, and of course, that is just a small example how this documentary film material, by the time it becomes a very powerful source of the history, you see. That happens not only with this material, with many of the materials, but when the film was made, of course, it was not very much, received well publicly. It was just criticized like one-sided, why you did not show the problems which politicians have raised on the meetings and whatever. But as Alfredo said a few minutes ago, it happened just that summer, 68, that the next much even stronger earthquake for the whole socialism happened in the world. And that was the Soviet occupation of Czech Republic, which was in that time Czechoslovakia Republic. That republic was also a socialistic state, and they wanted to go this different way of open socialism like Yugoslavia in that time did. So the leaders of Czech Republic, Dubček and other people, they have been very often visiting us, and our president Tito was there, like encouraging them. But the Soviet bloc, which was, as you know, on the heritage of Stalinism and very much against open debate, they invaded this brother republic of Czechoslovakia. And for us young people, then all the, one can say, promises and dreams of socialism came under very big question. Why? Because socialism was based on some very clear principles. For instance, one is proletarian internationalism, you see. Another, of course, is this open debates about the way how that type of society should be organized and how this organization would be able somehow to repair the mistakes and so on and so on. Everybody was speaking about the history of socialism, which begins in time when Marx and Engels have had the big debates with anarchists and so on and so on. And at once, it turned to this big dogmatism, which was in that time, in some moment, even bigger than anything what was happening in other parts of the world. The occupation of Czechoslovakia came, and just luckily, and also in the same time, as example how in that old system of socialism some of the things and in cultural life really functioned and some system exists. I got invitation by a big production house in Belgrade because I already produced 3-4 short films which will be shown here. Said, Jeremy, look, we are giving each year 2 or 3 films to new directors. Now you have made some quite interesting films. Let's make your first long film. In that time, you could not make a long film without quite substantial investment in technique and so on. So even a simple long film, feature film, would cost $150,000 or $200,000. Today, nobody would just give it. Nobody would offer you if you do not promise anything commercial. And I said to this producer, look, I have some experiences and I have some, I met some people during the student demonstration and I have seen them confused and I have seen them very angry and very, very much engaged that they would like to be a part of this emerging society here, so I would like to make a film about it. And the people in that camp said, okay, try, do it to be provocative, do it to be actually like somehow also putting all this question mark, what we have after student demonstration, after this, how would I say, changing of the cultural scheme in the whole world, and after our fears and doubts because of occupation of Czechoslovakia. Now you will see that film which I gave the title Early Works. Why? Because that was my first film, and second, because I was myself inspired by Karl Marx's early writings from 1848, which have been romantic, which have been partly based, of course, on French philosophers and Hegel. It was not any ideas of bureaucratic socialism. It was idea of the freedom of the men and working people. And you will see all those ideas, how we put it in the film, which was actually shot in autumn of 68. So 3 months after this, what you have seen now.
Estava falando da conexão, né? Do trabalho do Jelimir também com o cinema brasileiro, de certa forma, um ano antes, em 67, quando ele, na Itália, por intermédio do Lino Mitichè, o crítico, né, famoso, autor de livros sobre Visconti, etc., vai fazer uma... vai fazer uma... uma... apresenta uma seleção de filmes brasileiros, entre eles o Terra em Transe, do Glauber Rocha, e a Opinião Pública, do Arnaldo Jabor, e há essa conexão, né, com toda essa situação política que estava indo o mundo nesse período. Então, é interessante ver que a gente conversou sobre isso esses dias, como que Jelimir também teve contato com a obra do Glauber, né, e de outros cineastas brasileiros desse momento, né. Era só isso. E agora vamos ver finalmente o... É verdade?
Teoricamente, eu ainda não vi a legenda em inglês na tela, mas vamos desligar.
Bom, mas se tiver legenda em inglês, já a gente vê. Tá.
Oi? Don't fuss. It doesn't matter. Well, é sempre bom, antes de começar, falar alguma coisinha. Fazer alguns pequenos apontamentos para a gente começar a discussão. E uma coisa que me impressiona muito no filme é a quantidade de temas e espaços onde ele se dá. Então, você tem... questão da revolução, aquela velha discussão se ela deveria começar pelo campo ou pela cidade. A gente tem personagens que começam, o filme abre no campo, e uma ligação contínua de um espaço a outro. é um dado que, a meu ver, assim, que me impressiona muito, é que muitas vezes a trilha sonora, e aí eu estou me lembrando principalmente daquele momento onde você tem, onde eles estão no campo brincando de lutar, um momento um pouco... Se o discurso ele é bastante... Como eu diria, ele traz uma referência da situação, ele é muito consciente daquilo que se vive. Né? Então, é uma fala que ela é calcada numa discussão das diferentes possibilidades de caminhos que a política adotaria, dos limites mesmo que ela tem. Eu, naquele momento, olha, a revolução chega a ser niilista porque ela acredita que a tecnologia, ela efetivamente ela pode causar algo, né? A revolução mais impulsionada por uma situação material da sociedade do que pela política em si, né? Então, um descrédito em relação ao poder constituído. Mas, naquele momento que você tem aqueles pequenos personagens, aqueles brincando de guerra, praticamente, né? Porque... Ah, o som ele é muito rico, e aí eu volto para o som, parece até no meio de uma guerra, e a imagem tirando a fumaça é feita, dois ou três personagens que fazem mais uma coreografia não tão bélica, em algum momento bélica subindo, né, agachados ali na, como se estivesse numa trincheira, e em outro momento não, eles estão ali já. Mais balando, dançando. Né? Esse meu comentário é muito mais para você começar a falar e para o público esquentando com a sua fala e se motivar a perguntar. E outra questão também, só mais um pontinho, que é muito curioso, né? Em relação às relações... A gente tem nessa época, maio de 68, a Europa toda tá, e a América discutindo o direito de minorias... E aqui ele está imbuído numa virulência de uma política, da guerra. Né? Então, esse final mesmo ele é exemplar dessa situação, de como que o problema é resolvido. Então, é só para te motivar. Acho que você não precisa de motivação, porque você sabe muito bem falar. Mas vamos começar, para esquentar o pessoal.
Well, thank you. Yes. So thank you for your patience. Whenever I show our old films, I am aware that actually we are looking just a tiny piece of film history, because the film is made almost 50 years ago, and the film history only 110 years old. So. When I sit here thinking how you will feel, I was afraid that you will feel like if I would invite you to drive you in a Russian car Volga from 69. But luckily, this end of 60s was a very rich and vibrant moment of film language all over the world. Just think that is a time when, for instance, in America, Easy Rider was made, and in the same time, Andy Warhol made The Flash and Trash, and of course, on another side, in Hungarian cinematography, you have the people like Jancho, who was doing this choreography, and for instance, Godard did Chinese. But for us who have been living in a state socialism, we felt that we are actually in that moment between the heaven and the earth. Heaven is this ideology and promises of socialism, and down on the earth is a deep mud of dogmatism, and material world who is actually rejecting to get transferred towards these socialistic ideas and promises. And of course, we have been asking ourselves, what is the future of that concept? And why that this concept with such human promises does not function? So you see these references, as you said in the film. Maybe it is because actually the socialism was put in place in the very backward society, different than Karl Marx was actually predicting. And then you have these contradictions between, of course, working class, which is just emerging, and majority of peasants. And then, of course, this bureaucracy who is trying to stop all the debates and discussions about actually failing of fulfilling these humanistic ideals. And of course, inside of the film, it is also very present the youth of the authors and the crew, and energy and confusion. And on another side, there is these inspirations with this very vibrant moment of the world cinematography. So, of course, we loved Godard, but we thought that he is for us too naive. So, when I saw Chinese, I said, I will make the sequence just to show him how this so-called cultural revolution is stupid and inhuman and destructive. And on another side, of course, we wanted to come out with this actually not hippie alike treating the bodies and the games and the play and the choreography, but more referring to this myth of socialism, how the youth would have the most important place in society, and they are all the time put aside as the socialistic nomenclatura start actually being formed by old people and when they grab the power, they all have been very young. So this hidden generation clash for us young people was very important. And of course, that was also the moment when in our country, we had the whole group, 5 or 10, very, I would say, articulated and good directors. Some of them are mentioned in this book. So ex-Yugoslav films between 65 and 72 or 3, they have been quite well known all over the world. That was something very similar to this new Brazilian film. So I was just a part of that movement, but among the youngest. And for me and my crew, was important to avoid also the type of stories they have been making. So these stories about so-called modest, small working men who who is like very much trying to be like modestly critical towards the, you know, the mistakes of the regime. So we want to say, no, we don't, we cannot discuss about mistakes of the regime. We should discuss about the whole sense that it has, does it has any really strength and possibility to survive and to go further on. So our, we in the crew, we said, let's make some sort of ballad about the time and promises of our youth, you see. So you see, that is why the film has this feeling of, I don't know, maybe you can say father, you see. And it was when we filmed 68. So in that moment came one melody to be very well known on the radio. That is this what was called "Those Were the Days, My Friends." Like we are saying farewell to one epocha, to one portion of the time, because it seems that the world will just turn otherwise. But still, you see, this society where we, this film made, it was open for the big debate about this film and many others. So it started to be shown in the country. Half of the critics have been for it, half against it. Then the court, the court announced a process against the film. And but the atmosphere was like that. That I, who finished 3 or 4 years before Los Hadis, I said to producer, I'm going to defend the film. So I was having a very harsh and brutal fight with the public prosecutor, shouting on him that you don't believe in our society, you think that this small film can ruin the society. You don't understand humor, you have not read Marx and whatever. And judge was listening to us, and he made a break and said to the people, go out. And called me and said, look, young man, are you drunk? I said, no. He said, did you smoke grass? I said, no. Then he said, don't you know that he had seen the film? So he pointed on the picture of Tito. I said, I have heard the rumors, but if he has seen it, he's old man, and he must be disturbed with this naked young woman. And then the judge said to me, but did you do anything against this type of production, what we have, which was called self-government system, very similar to actually filmmakers' cooperatives. I said, no, we have been following that that system. That means that in our type of socialism, we filmmakers, we have not been employed, we have been freelance, so we would make a contract with production company. They will give us technical facilities and laboratories, and we are not going to take fees, so we are also investing in production. And I said, no, we did it. And then the judge said to me, okay, then call the witnesses, these people from production and here and there, and I will allow debate. And then there was really 3-4 days, big public debate. Does socialistic system has a freedom to reflect about itself or not, and so on. And on the end, the judge stood out, and he said, you made a very boring film. Film does not look like a real professional film. You are unable to make a normal love scene with kissing. So I'm sure our working class will not watch it. But the film cannot harm our, no boring film can harm our country. So he let it free. And film was quite good, shown all over the world. It was sold in 45 countries. And you will say, okay, but that was a state-funded film. And just to explain you this moment of this black way of making of films, producer, that big company with laboratory, they took a loan from the bank. They did not go on some subsidies. No, took a loan from the bank and earned four times money what they have asked. So, you see, so of course that was exactly as we are speaking about this time, that was this specific moment which did not last long. After 71, 72, I would say the whole state socialism came to some moment of actually being without any creative solutions how to proceed further. And all of us filmmakers who have been working doing critical films have been stopped of working further on. So I went and spent some years making films in Germany.
Alguém tem alguma questão?
Mas o aspecto que eu queria trazer é certas relações de formais, digamos, no bom sentido, entre que nós vemos esse grupo de jovens que não está num apartamento em Paris, mas está atravessando um espaço, um território da então Iugoslávia, e tendo uma experiência que eu digo, uma teatralização, né, da experiência presente, com esses objetivos de criar interrogações, provocações, que me parecem dão uma grande vivacidade, um grande interesse. Agora, me chamou muito a atenção o fato de que esses espaços não são espaços de produção, no sentido de algo que se faz e faz avançar. Pelo contrário, são ou terrenos enfim, do ponto de vista assim, de uma paisagem que não, não destaca a agricultura, pelo contrário, destaca lugares onde não há sinais de trabalho. Né? Fábricas um pouco ruínas, tem muitas ruínas, ou lugares sem desativados, são espaços que pouco assim, no man's land, né? Que estabelece essa sensação de que é um momento entre dois, quer dizer, um momento de impasse, um momento de dificuldade de sentir que há um futuro. Ao mesmo tempo, não se aceita o passado. E nesse sentido, eu acho que há algumas questões que, em termos de soluções formais, de mise-en-scène, de trabalho com os atores e tal, lembram do Godard, mas o seu filme é bem diferente, eu sei. Eu gostaria de um comentário seu sobre essas questões que esses jovens colocam, um pouco aquela dinâmica do grupo, que é uma dinâmica um pouco autofágica, como também no próprio Godard, a gente vê os jovens no apartamento, para fazer um comentário sobre esta questão de um filme de 67, mas enfim, ficou muito ligado em 68, feito pela Nouvelle Vague francesa, e este filme feito pela Black Wave. E me lembrei de outro fato, uma das coisas que me chocou muito no filme com o qual eu tenho problemas, que é o Vento do Leste, Van Destin, do Godard, é que se existe algo que ele critica com muita veemência é a Iugoslávia de Tito e a autogestão. Eu gostaria de saber se há algum comentário no contexto dos lados sobre essa posição, que para mim foi muito estranha, do Godard, nesse filme de 68, Vento do Leste.
Well, definitely, most of everything what you said, you are very right, and in the answers, I don't have to hide, first of all, that I was not having much experience, especially in fiction stories, because before this film, I made only 4 documentaries. So I myself felt completely unsure how to direct dialogues and how to somehow articulate emotions. This what is actually the most important tool in a fiction film. Me and my cinematographer actually have not been practiced till then. Also, the concept and the text for the film, we wrote almost 95% as it is in film. But no of famous actors wanted to act. First of all, lady says, I'm not going to be half of the time naked, I'm stupid, whatever. And the man says, I want to seduce the woman that she felt in love with me, not to have a political debate with her. So our casting is actually mostly of non-professional actors. And of course, in that time for me, Godard was among the 3-4 greatest artists in the world. And he was someone who really have turned not only art of filming, but somehow the audience and way of looking of the films, because in our country, we have been watching all Godard's films in the cinemas. Yugoslavia in that time was like a test country where before the Germany and England, the films from the West have been coming to us. But regarding the topic, what we had here, that is ideology and reality, we really felt that we are much more experienced to speak about so-called state socialism and to be ironic or critical towards that type of society than the people who did not live in that type of society, you see. So I think that, as you said, those comments of Godard, they are simple, I would say, not appropriate, as actually I would not be the right one who could make a film about, let us say, colonial heritage of Brazil, and then give you some remarks and lessons that maybe you should not use Portugal language, which was a language of colonialism, you see? And I would think, I am right, you are wrong, and so, but I'm stupid because I'm out of the life, you see? So that is how we... And of course, I am speaking about this moment when the language of film was so rich between visual experiments and essays. But for me, in that moment, the main film as inspiration for this topic, how the young people react on this possibility and difficulty of creating of new, actually, society. The main film was Alexander Medvedkin, Happiness, which he made in, as you know, 23, I think. And which is still, for me, at least on the level of Eisenstein, and never put so high by the film history, you see. And somehow this story is following some elements of his story of the young teacher who comes in the villages. So this question of the agricultural areas and peasants and the workers, that is this huge, I would say, question mark under the state socialism. Why? Because, as you know, the ideology, Marx ideology, was somehow asking for completely eliminating of the peasant class, and in our country peasants have been 75% of population feeding all the people, you see. And you are right about this choosing of the places, you see. Maybe I made mistake. I said to the man who was helping us to choose a place, find in the area where we live, and we live in northern Serbia, which used to be a part of big Austrian monarchy. So in that region, which is agricultural region, very early Austrians have been making agricultural industry with these primitive sort of factories and these old machines and so on. So I said to the crew, let's find those places to refer on actually commenting industrialization of England in Engels and Marx works. But maybe it is today so complicated to be understood, so maybe I agree to say that it is mistake, you see. It is too big, like a rebus. I like this film very much, and I like a memory on that moment, how we made it, and I liked struggles. But if you ask me, do I put this film among my first five or maybe 10 films which I like most, I would say not actually.
Não, eu queria só expressar que eu gostei do filme e que a observação sobre a paisagem... Não, eu Só queria dizer que eu gostei também muito do filme, mas a observação sobre a paisagem não era uma crítica, era uma interrogação minha, porque agora ele me deu razões, mas, não, mas antes disso me chamou a atenção o aspecto de uma coerência de estilo que está ligada à própria... Eu chamei de teatro aqui, dos jovens, né, nesse sentido de uma experiência, né, provocativa em que se vai numa direção, se vai noutra, incorpora determinadas frases de uma ideologia oficial, mas, ao mesmo tempo, se faz muita ironia em relação a tudo isso. Não, está ok, acho. Só queria esclarecer esse ponto aqui.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you, thank you.
Em que há uma... Não, eu acho que existe uma coisa extremamente violenta no Vento Leste, é a crítica ao Tito e à Iugoslávia e à autogestão.
Well, I did not give the answer, but that is a very big question, you see. When I was even younger, two or three years before I start making films, I was doing some programming one institution with social debates and reflecting, and in that time in our country, that means 62, 63, the most famous thinkers in the world have been coming all the time having big debates. So I personally have seen Erich Fromm, Kosick, Marcuse, many others of these philosophers, Sartre, and they will be in Yugoslavia saying, we are in the place which is realizing the dreams of romantic philosophy and so on. And we youngsters, we try to calm them down, say, look, you should go in our factories, you should go in our villages. They say, no, no, you are thinking too banal and too concrete. You see, Tito has this vision. Yes, also. But what we have seen that in this concept of this socialism, which is not completely unison, the political elite is misusing the economic position and power. Different parts of working class to actually make a platform that they argue between each other, not to threaten one party system dictatorship. And unfortunately, that internal debates not only debates, but the tensions, that was very much misused by political elite after Tito's death to cause the civil war. Because if you, from this very distant, faraway countries of ours, would ask me, what for the God's sake was your civil war? What is it? I would say that was a war between local feudals for succession of a king Tito. And that thing you have seen through the history thousands of times, from the Roman time to even today in Ukraine and so on. So I did not follow exactly the arguments of Godard, but some self-destruction was unfortunately settled in the system.
Boa noite. Eu senti no filme muito presente a questão assim, da juventude e da vontade de questionar e transformar a organização social. Eu imagino que essa era uma vontade que você tinha também quando fez o filme. E eu queria perguntar em que medida você sente que conseguiu realizar um debate ou pelo menos levar as pessoas a questionar o que estava acontecendo na sociedade naquela época.
Well, to be honest, one of the main reasons that I'm sort of magnetized with making film for so long is my big surprise how this small medium of ours, which is nothing else but shadows and light, can so strongly galvanize society and in many cases can really open debate and sometimes even the change, the trends in terms of course, of taste, of reflexing. Then also in terms of self-irony, which can come instead of some sort of stupid dogmatism, which turns out. Just minutes ago, we have been speaking about Tito as authoritarian leader with the lot of elements of dictatorship. But interesting was when his assistants, after his death, start dividing the country, in the same time they start completely sweeping off, brushing off the whole history and memory. Even identity of these 20 million people. And in that atmosphere, I just thought what to do. And I made in only 8 hours, 2 days, four-hour shooting, a small film happening, which you are going to see here. It is called Tito Among the Serb for the second time. So that small thing, in a how would I say, fascistic, neo-Nazistic moment in the country, illegally start being broadly distributed among the people and tremendously change the atmosphere, you see? I mean, I was one who absolutely should not be much in favor of Tito because in his time I had to leave the country. But I was against those lies, you see? And that is not only case I can talk for hours. So definitely my answer on your question is positive. Yes, yes, that is this miracle that this our medium from time to time in various society does really bring. Of course, it doesn't give solutions. It does not give any real answers the society should, like, put in some laws or whatever, but it changed atmosphere. Because, you know, film is this type of mirror, sort of society always. Because whatever you film, it is always a piece, if not of reality, but of those seconds and minutes your camera was working. Those are, I think, Godard words, you see. So when you watch these two films, you can just see how the landscape looked like. And you can see that in the time when in America they could make Easy Rider, because they hated society, but they have had these nice big actually roads and these nice motorcycles, you see, and these colorful things, and we had to stay in mud, you see. And I mean, if you just take anything like old film with Marlon Brando on New York docks, you will have a piece of history of that city, which is today completely transferred. Today, where the docks were, is now is new, very fashionable stores and whatever. So that is this magnetism and mirroring of reality. Maybe that is one of the strength, beside the stories and beside the ideas.
Eu queria perguntar, Zemir, sobre essa presença de um elemento documental nos seus filmes. Você mencionou que antes do Early Works você tinha feito 4 documentários. Eu não sei, a impressão que eu tive é que esse filme também tem um peso documental muito grande. Eu queria que você falasse um pouco sobre a presença desse elemento no seu trabalho.
Well, as you know, as a student of film medium, this generally distinction and the language between documentary and fiction, that is a big question for the history of the film. So I am among this half of the people who think that actually film is different from the theater. Theater is a type of symbolic language, because the stage is this general space where everything is happening. In one moment it is a court, in another moment it is a railway station, in a third moment it is a prison. In the film you have to bring somehow realism in front of your camera. And therefore, I'm myself very much interested in the things which somehow are created from the environment and the people in the moment, also when you are realizing a piece of your written story. So you will see here maybe 5, 6, 7 of my actually fiction films, but they are at least combine with documentary on the way that I have a concept and a script, and I do write a rough version of each scene, but then I give it to the people who are making interpretation and ask them, how do you feel there? Do you have something to add? Do you have a specific language of yours you will use? And I observe that, and then in many cases I see how actually they are putting not only their experiences but also their energy and creativity. And I do not feel disturbed. You see, it is also the question, you must understand that everything what I am telling, they are not the rules. They are not the rules. Because each of us, like a painters, you see, some painters will sit and make the painting of a fruit with a strong colors and whatever, and another one will the same thing will do only with the pencil, you see, and he feels that it is authentic. So I'm not giving the recipe, but I see I tell you how I feel. So for me, the big drive is actually this moment of unexpected and the moment of risk whenever we are when we are planning this creation of the scene, you see. So I would feel very much bored if I would work, for instance how some people are doing, that they say, we wrote everything till the very detail, so you go and read it and just realize it, and do not make any mistake. If you make mistake, we will just stop that take and make another one. No, I will. I am this one who are very curious. Did someone of the people who are interpreting my ideas, did they understand it actually on a more interesting way than I did it? But it is a question of a very personal methodology. So you can say that actually my films are this combining documentary and fiction, which is in today's production method quite often applied.
Aproveitando o ensejo, a pergunta do Henrique, né, sobre a questão do documentário. Observando a obra do Gelimir como um todo, em alguns momentos eu já me questionei a respeito da ociosidade dessas categorias ficção e documentário no cinema dele, tamanha a contaminação, inclusive nos filmes mais recentes, né? Um pouco essa questão me leva a indagar aqui, também considerando toda a obra dele, né, e alguns desses filmes vão ser exibidos aqui, provavelmente o pessoal vai ter contato, eu me pergunto, queria saber como que ele se coloca diante dessa minha indagação. Eu percebo, da parte dele, talvez mais ainda do que em outros cineastas do leste europeu, um impulso no sentido de se postar como uma testemunha ocular das transformações que estão ocorrendo, não só no país dele, mas até no continente e talvez no mundo. E um filme dele em particular, que vai, acho que vai ser exibido aqui, o One Woman, One Century, eu percebo que funciona como uma espécie de metáfora dessa posição dele enquanto cineasta observador, testemunho ocular, né, de transformações, que é um documentário sobre uma senhora bastante idosa e muito lúcida e que atravessou diversos regimes, né, políticos. E o filme é muito vivo e às vezes me dá a impressão até dela ser, em certa medida, um alter ego do Jelimia naquela postura, né, de observação e de crítica. Eu queria saber da parte dele se ele continua, inclusive, em atividade, que eu acho que é um dado muito importante. E me parece que nessa fase final da mais recente, né, da obra dele, inclusive, me parece recorrente o tema da questão da identidade nacional e da imigração, dos fluxos migratórios na Europa e no mundo, né? Eu queria saber se ele se vê mesmo como esse observador, né, dessas transformações e o que que ele que ele acredita que vale a pena observar hoje em dia, que ele está vendo de mais notório, impressionante ou significativo.
Deixa eu só completar, porque a questão que eu ia colocar, quando você fala da imigração, eu estava pensando justamente no filme Inventory, que ele fez entre 73 e 76, quando ele morou na Alemanha. É um curtinha muito simpático que vai passar aqui. E já traz isso, né? E eu ia fazer uma pergunta sobre como você compõe a cena, mas eu acho que é uma marca que você traz, é que ele é um filme completamente posado com imigrantes, né? Então, vem corroborar um pouquinho o que que o Alfredo fala sobre essa mesa.
Well, again, of course, it is question of choice and question of taste and question of inspiration. So we talked about state socialism just a few minutes ago, but then after that we had also time of civil war and now time of post-communism. So if you would ask me, have the contradiction been the greatest in state socialism, I would say together with 90% of the people on the Balkans, no, it was the most peaceful time in the whole 1,000 years of history when those people have come on Balkans. This, what is happening in civil war and in post-communism, that is actually this 960 years of wars, of carnage, of actually aggressivity, of plundering, of suppressing working people, of unemployment, of misery, of actually being completely despised all over the world. That I never thought before. And all those people who said, let us go to capitalism, they did not know that it will happen. So you see, I continue making films because I simply see there are so many areas, first of all, in human life, in human relationship, and then also in society as a general, where from year to year, your mainstream medias are more restricted to write and speak than in socialistic time. And that is one of the greatest surprises of mine. So Alfredo said that I made that film with this lady who is now 102 years old. Why I did it? When she called me 3 years ago, she said, Jeremy, I am following your career, but now I came out of jail. Did you also finish all your jail sentences? I said to her, no, Dragica, I was not in jail. She said, how come? I have seen so many articles against you. I said, no, I always run away or whatever. She said, no, I couldn't. I was in the jail before the Second World War. I was in the jail during the Second World War. I was in the jail in Tito's regime. Come to my place. I'm a bit old now. I want to tell you a few stories. And I went there, and when I start listening her tremendous, excellent memory, I saw I have in front of me the only one person on the Balkans who is telling truth, who is not lying about her past, and who is not lying what she did, and who is not lying about all those societies before. You see, so she said, I said, but Dragice, when the things start being difficult, I said, Želimir, in 1915, when my father died in the First World War, and then Mussolini came to power, and he, fascism in Italy, and he took part of our country, and we had to change the names. And I and my brothers, we went illegally in Communist Party because that party was for this internationalism. And then she was coming on. And I said, look, it is something what one should try to put on film, although it is so difficult. She is old, she is hardly moving, she does not hear well, although she is very clever. And I said, okay, Dragice, I want to make film with you about your life, but we must move from your apartment because here is, I mean, nothing and it's so boring. Do you have any wish where to travel? She said, yes, I want to go in my birthplace on the seaside. And I said, okay, and where else? She said, I want to go to Moscow, because in 49, I was one who brought Tito's letter to Stalin and wait there 1 week until Stalin and Molotov answers, and then I came back, but I did not know that Stalin has accused also my husband, and Tito put me and my husband in the jail. And, of course, that was a challenge for me. Now I felt more like challenged. Do I have a sort of way and method how to make out of this minimum possibility something what can last 120 minutes? And we did it. And then also came in place this mystery of film. So we made a long film, and I thought we'll put it in a library. But let us make premiere. So we had the first showing in Belgrade, and it was great success, and cinema took it and ran it 2 months. And then all capitals of new countries like Zagreb, Croatia, Ljubljana, Slovenia, Sarajevo, Bosnia, they took the film and started running it. So that lady, who was no one, she became the woman who was having the most number of articles ever in our languages, so like 1,000 articles. And then I was approached by television director, said, Želimir, We heard in your interview that you have a lot of material. Can you make a TV serial? So it is... I mean, you see, it's a mystery of film. It is not my skill, you see. And it is no investment, nothing. You see, but why? But why? You know, it is like you see the thousands of people are marching towards the wind, and wind is blowing, and they cannot breathe. And they say, "Ah, we will choke. And then just one say, "Turn the background," and you will start breathing, you see. So that is what she did. Well, that is what she did. She started telling the truth, and I was in Zagreb when she said, "People, I am from the neighboring village. We should not lie. During the fascistic time, we had fascistic regime here, which now today's post-communist government tries to like free from responsibility. I can say, because I was witnessing that, they have been worse than Hitler. So be proud, stand up against it, you see. So can you imagine, she with 102 years started being the first anti-fascistic activist in the country. I met her a week ago in Belgrade, and she said, she asked me, "Look, Jeremy, shall we do one more film?" And she comes with stories you would not remember. I said, "But do you have some more stories?" She said, "Yes, of course." My very close friend, she's much younger, she's only 89. She has a very good friend in Italy who is actress, and we together have been very often to this. You have heard for Giulietta Masina. I said, "Yes." "You know, there we have been sitting and drinking coffee and always arguing about Italian pasta. Because have you heard for this Federico, you know this fat Federico?" I said, "Yes." "Yeah, Fellini, he never knew that pasta can be made with potatoes, so I was making always for him potatoes, pasta." So she has this. You see, so that is what happens, you see. You cannot those things predict. But of course, what is my experience? My experience is that if you feel comfortable, it is good just to grab the piece of factuality, because you see it can either fade away or run away. So definitely, if you say, what is my concept? If someone asks me, "What do you do?" I would say, "Yes, I'm trying to make like my personal diary about different tendencies and times we have passed through." And it does comes out, and it is not only my case. That happens with many films all over the world, that they are somehow understood also as a piece of history, or maybe the history, sort of the source of the history, you see. But to be honest, I do not think that this type of films are the best or the only films. No, it is a very small marginal part of a great cinematography, which is today on a good way different than when I was young. So you young people, you would say, when we listen, you old people, we think it was easy for you because the market was big, the many cinemas have been there, and you have a good communication. No, we have had 1,000 times more less chance than you do because of technology, because of actually complicated communication. Only to send a letter from Brazil to Cannes and to New York and from Serbia, that was 1,000 times more complicated than to write email today and to make DVDs. And of course, there are not so many cinemas, but there are new medias, you see. In 50s and 60s, televisions hardly existed. But now, television is, of course, on one side, replacing moving images, but on another side, the television is the greatest distributor of our films. So I, having these very small pieces, you see, see each week in our region at least 3 films shown on various television. So even if you have this low budget, modest films, you cannot have less than 500,000 views, you see. So it is 10 times more than for the best book, you see. So we have this privilege. And you especially, you have this privilege that you can now start the project without any big support or any big, authority you are asking, you see. And my crews and myself, we feel blessed that this new technology exists. You cannot imagine. You do, Ken, because in this school you have also old cameras and all editing rooms. So to edit the film on 35 millimeters or 16 millimeters, it is simple. 50 times more complicated and more expensive than to do it on computer. And of course, you always have to bear in mind that, like in all goods, the market is very divided. So the Hollywood film making is one area, and this personal low budget filmmaking is another. But on the end, we all come on this silver screen or on computer. And on the end, everything, our results are judged by authenticity and by visual power of that, you see. And of course, there are so many contradictions. For instance, some years ago, there was a meeting between Hollywood filmmaking group and European filmmakers. So 300 of us came in BAFTA, that is British Academy for Film and Television. And president was Attenborough. So he said, and from Americans came only 6 of them. The oldest was oldest of Alfredo. So Attenborough says, look, colleague, let's be human. We are showing each year 5,000 of American films, and you do not show more than 25 European films. Why are you doing so? And they said, look, we try, but I mean, we invest a lot of money trying to show European film, but no one wants to see it because your stories are not understandable. And then Attenborough says, but we are doing Shakespeare. I did a lot of Shakespeare and those guys. And the American young guy says, but nobody knows what Shakespeare wants to say. And even you don't have an answer, who is Shakespeare? And then Atterbury said, don't say those stupidity, you are speaking English language. Let's go in concrete. Why you invest in each film now $200 million, $300 million and more? And then those six guys said, who is making the big investment? So a young guy came and said, I started with Broken Arrow, and then I did the Independence Day. So that was 150,000 euro, million euros, 200 million euros. Now I am doing, I don't know, Noah, or whatever, $5 million. And he said, you know why I'm investing only 500 millions? And we said, why? Because I don't want to receive more money. I have so many banks and Chinese who ask me to take a billion, because filmmaking is the most profitable business. It is when it is successful. It is better than drug dealing, and it is better than producing the arms. And then Ben Kingsley came, said, look, gentlemen, why do you give to American actors such a big fees, like $15 million, $22 million? We cannot compete that. So the mayor says, who is having these big names like, Robert De Niro, Faye Dunaway? So young lady came, I'm having them. Why are you giving them such much money? She said, because they don't want to take 30 millions. I would give each of them 30 millions because they make that money. But they take only 15 and then are pressing me for the percentage. You see, so on the end, they get 60, you see. So you see, so that is this global economy. Of course, that those big films, they are using actors as brands, you see. And they are, then of course, some of Europeans say, but you are making these simple stories, cowboy and Indians and so on, criminals and policemen. And they said, yes, nobody can understand European history. Said, you must bear in mind that millions of Europeans came in United States just to forget and to avoid the history, confusions of the history. You see, so it is definitely top of the world cinematography and the Chinese and those big markets. But for young people, I would always suggest do not wait until someone offers you these dozens of millions. Make your own pieces, start simple, and see what are your tastes, what is your temper, what are your feelings, because someone feels good if the film is full of action. Someone feels good if is full with emotions, and you will not know it until you do not just dive into the practice. So another thing which keeps me so long in making films is that I have passed through quite a lot of these adventures of making the films, so I do not have frustration of the long breaks, what many my dear talented colleagues do, you see, and that is very frustrating, you see. So in Europe you have excellent directors who are waiting on a state funding, always 5 to 7 years between film and film. So in one career, on that way, you cannot make more than, let us say, 10 pieces. And I mean, life is, for me, too complicated to be packed in 10 stories. You can ask whatever you want, because, like I said, I am not very frustrated. I am also not very frustrated to answer any question or to understand any critic.
primeiro filme, das imagens de 68, tão vivas, me lembrou o Faroque. E eu sei que você passou um tempo na Alemanha. Eu queria saber se tem alguma relação. Ele viu os seus filmes? A gente falou de um diálogo com o cinema francês, com o cinema americano. Mas tem também um diálogo aí. Na cena tem também o cinema alemão. Como é que é isso?
Oh, yes. Well, just when we are speaking about that film done in 68, that was the moment when I already have seen Santiago Alvarez's films. So I understand that one can make like film pamphlets. So that encouraged me. And regarding the German cinematography, funny information is that this ex-Yugoslav kinematography in 66, 67, 68, 69 was more important than the German, because German new film came after 73. So when I...
What I'm asking is whether they know your film.
Oh, yes. Yes, I was many times, four or five times awarded in Oberhausen. And in Oberhausen, I met Kluge, I met Edgar Reitz, Herzog, Ulla Sokol, then also Siebeberg. We have been together in the debate because this German atmosphere after the Second World War was very open for cultural debate. And we have been very well received. And my films first run on German television very early. So all of my short films, not only mine, but about each year, 25 short films run on German television and about 10 long films. So that was a short period when we have been like quite good, respectable cinematography. But then afterwards, when I went in Germany, I just found easily some contact with the production which was called Film Verlag der Autoren, which was actually Filmmakers Cooperative, where the whole group worked. So I produced together with them 7 short films. In some of them, my cinematographer was Thomas Mauch, who was working with, for instance, on those films on in your country with Herzog, and I was using the studio and facility what they have. So 7 short films and 1 long film I did in Germany, and those films are still quite well appreciated there. For instance, the first film about this Rote Armee Fraktion, what we call Bader-Meinhof Group, I did actually before Fassbinder. And I knew Fassbinder quite well. Fassbinder was one of the greatest guys, but privately he was, you know, very prepared to struggle and to quarrel and to be aggressive. And in the film, he was so full of emotion and understanding. And if you see his films, they are just soul, nothing else.
Queria fazer mais uma pergunta. Alguém tem, a gente vê se alguém quer mais alguma coisa, mas a hora já está avançando, uma para poder fechar. que é sobre a televisão. Você falou que você não ficou desempregado, que você sempre fez trabalhos, e a gente sabe que quando você voltou para da Alemanha, a sua alternativa de trabalho era a televisão. E seu trabalho com a televisão, a gente estava discutindo que essa ideia de gênero é difícil de pensar no seu trabalho, documentário, ficção. Tem uma certa cinematografia onde isso é mais visível, mas na sua você gosta de ficar na borda. Em relação à televisão, tem alguma diferença no seu trabalho com cinema? Como é que é isso? Queria que você comentasse um pouco.
Oh, yes. Well, you see, that is also a big surprise, and I also would propose to each of you to see if there are some space on television to either produce and put your films. So in old Yugoslavia, we had some programs which have been called like TV original film, which run each Monday at 8 o'clock. So that means that televisions of all republic had to produce 52 long films. But we could do it. I did it as a freelance. So I would go and propose the topics, and they will sometimes reject, and sometimes they will take it. So you then had opportunity to make 90 minutes film on 16 millimeters negative. So when I make a list of my 10 best pieces, four are from this television production. Not only because they are like well done, but also regarding some sort of provocativity. I think in this list of the films, you will show one or two or three also. So simple, television, it always depends the situation in society, but television is swallowing very many films. It is a good platform. They need material, and sometimes you can find the place for your topic. And I have seen that in Germany, that actually they also used to have original film produced with the help of television. So many French New Wave films have been produced with help of German television. So that means Godard and the others have been often taking the support of television. So that is the situation which is changing. Nowadays, in post-socialism, televisions are worse propaganda than in time of socialism, and all the cultural programs are cut off completely.
Comunicar a todos que estiverem interessados, o Jeremy vai dar um workshop aqui na quarta e na quinta, né, à tarde, aqui na ECA, e esse workshop ele vai conseguir expor com mais clareza o método dele, né, a transformação do método dele enquanto cineasta no decorrer do tempo, né, como vocês puderam ver, ele foi aí ao longo de sua carreira, trabalhou sempre com, não sempre, mas em alguns casos com orçamentos limitadíssimos e conseguiu extrair o máximo de inventividade nessas situações. E também uma marca do cinema dele é o trabalho com mistura de atores profissionais e não profissionais, alguns filmes inclusive só com atores não profissionais, né? E então essas e outras questões vão ser trazidas aí para discussão durante o workshop. Então, quarta e quinta tarde, a partir das 14h, quem tiver interesse está convidado.
Bom, gente, então, eu quero agradecer muito a presença de todos. Lembrando, né, como já tinha dito, quem quiser participar do workshop, manda um e-mail para o Sinusp, porque a gente está com medo de não caber em nossa sala. E agradecer muito a Zilimir mesmo, sua presença aqui com a gente. E, bom, a gente continua, temos mais uma semana de trabalhos e ele encerra.
I'm also very thankful for this opportunity. You see, for me, it's all, you know, for me, it's not coming here just an excursion to see how my films have been received. For me, it is a great curiosity for different society I'm in, you see. So today, I just took your newspaper and tried to read it, and of course, I was surprised when I see, because I, of course, have been taught Latin, I can follow the topic. So I was surprised how you are now debating a lot of very open topic for your society. I mean, from this strike here and the position of universities and politicians and corruption and the situation with this big topic about World Cup, which is also so contradictional, because it is actually the greatest love of Brazilian people and in the same time the greatest critique. So, I mean, we did not know when we read in European papers about Brazil, it is only this very successful economic story which threatens tiny, poor Europe.
Gente, então só para terminar, só porque ele falou hoje, ele falou que ele está no Brasil há 4 dias e que ele está muito tranquilo, que pela primeira vez ninguém pergunta para ele quando ele está viajando de onde você é mesmo, é que ele está passando como um brasileiro que é bem confortável.